Did you know that the Pop Culture Preservation Society depends on support from listeners like you to keep our podcast up and running? We are an independent operation, creating, producing, distributing, and promoting the podcast by ourselves and paying for it out of our own pockets because we love it and we think it's worth it to preserve the well-loved cultural nuggets from our Gen X youth. If you'd like to become a supporter of the PCPS, go to patreon.com, P-A-T-R-E-O-N, and search for Pop Culture Preservation Society. Our Patreon supporters are like our pit crew, giving us the fuel we need to keep on trucking. And as a Patreon supporter, you'll also get special thank you gifts, like video recordings of our episodes, after-the-episode discussions, invitations to live events over Zoom, and the occasional blooper delivered straight to your inbox. Thank you so much for listening and for being a part of our society. I want him to be there, and I want him to be alone, and I want him to be sad, and I want him even to come over, and you could still do the thing about, I think that line is important about, I always believed in you, I just didn't believe in me. And then she could say, I'm happy for you, Blane. Now, why don't you take your newfound knowledge and go be a better person?
Yes.
Hello, world, is a song that we're singing. Come on, get happy. A whole lot of loving is what we'll be bringing. We'll make you happy.
Welcome to the Pop Culture Preservation Society, the podcast for people born in the Big Wheel generation who never wore a dress without pantyhose, aka nylons, probably packaged in a plastic egg.
We believe our Gen X childhoods gave us unforgettable songs, stories, characters, and images. And if we don't talk about them, they'll disappear, like Marshall, Will, and Holly on a routine expedition.
And today, we're saving the unforgettable movie that gave many of us a rallying cry at a time when we really needed it.
Someone let them know that they didn't break me.
Pretty in Pink.
I'm Carolyn.
I'm Kristen.
And I'm Michelle. And we are your pop culture preservationists. We all have that one movie that we can watch over and over and over again. The one that for some reason reached into your soul, grabbed you, and shook really hard. It's the movie we can still quote lines from and often do. The movie we know every word of the soundtrack. It's also the movie that your kids won't ever watch with you, no matter how much you beg them to, because you are the one who asked them to watch it. Right?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Well, for me and for many of our listeners, that movie is the 1986 John Hughes classic, Pretty in Pink. Woo, I feel like this. Applause. Applause, 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 as Iona would say. You guys, this movie is one of, if not the most affecting movie of my life. I've seen it more times than I could even know, and it's like every scene is ingrained in my brain. I can close my eyes and I can call up the movie and the entire thing just plays behind my eyelids like they're a giant movie screen from start to finish. I first saw Pretty in Pink in 1986 when it opened with my best friend Lisa Callen, and we instantly knew we'd seen something special. We knew we'd seen a movie that would live with us and in us forever. And I can still feel how that felt when the movie was over. And we loved it so much, but it wasn't just like that was such a good movie. We knew it was like next level.
It's hot. White hot.
It spoke to me on a level I don't think any other movie ever had before. And that's because John Hughes just got what it was like to be 17. How you can feel like you don't fit in. That feeling kind of being less than others sometimes. And even if you were nothing like Andie, and I really wasn't, that feeling resonated. The whole excitement and confusion of young love, it was all so real to me. Also, playing a huge factor for me was Andie's cool, retro, kind of thrift store granny style, which I just adored, but knew that I could never pull off.
Right,
her purple Carmen Ghia, you guys, her purple Carmen Ghia became my dream car for like the next 5 years. The music, oh my God, the hilarity of the other iconic misfits, Duckie and Iona, and oh yes, Andrew McCarthy, you guys. Andrew McCarthy was my Brat Pack crush. I know you might think it was Rob Lowe because grown-up me crushes on him so hard. But when I was 17, Rob Lowe was like too ridiculously perfect For me, it felt too unattainable to me because I wasn't like that type of girl who, you know, well, first of all, I didn't have a boyfriend, but like that was way out. He was way out of my league to even dream about, to even crush on. But Andrew McCarthy was just right. And Lord, you guys, I swooned. I swooned so hard for him. And I want to make it clear, though, I crushed hard on Andrew McCarthy. But interestingly, I found then and now lots of fault with Blane. And we're going to talk about that as we get into the movie. Right now, though, I want to know, Kristen, I want to know about your first experience with this movie.
So Pretty in Pink and really all the movies of John Hughes taught me that the suburbs of Chicago were full of snooty rich people big brick houses, and they listened to really good music there. And so I really felt like it was a geography lesson. And my timeline lines up exactly with Pretty in Pink. I was a senior in high school. I was getting ready for the prom that I didn't get invited to at the exact same time that Andie was. And so I watched it almost with a sense of nostalgia, like this will all be behind me soon. It should have been a really important movie for me, but I left the theater feeling like I'd been slapped in the face.
Aww.
I really did. And we will not talk about exactly why right now. We're going to save that for later. But I was so bothered by the end of the movie that I carry a little nugget of confusion and incredulity in my heart about Pretty in Pink. Like, what just happened?
Yeah.
For me, this movie is dripping in privilege and pain.
Yes. Well, as you all obviously know, my first encounter with the movie was about 4 days ago, as we watched it together at Kristen's house. And so, of course, I had to go back and think, why didn't I see this when it came out? Yeah. And it's pretty obvious to me when we say the time and the date. It was 1986, so I was in college. We didn't go to the movies when I was in college. And we were going to parties on weekends. I mean, not a lot of us even had cars, and this was – you'd have to drive to the movie theater. But anyway, so – I think that was why. And I think also it was kind of a high school movie. And I was like, a late junior. I was going to be a senior in college. It just didn't come across my radar. So I did not see that movie earlier on. So I want to point out, when we saw it 4 days ago, I went into it with midlife progressive glasses on.
Yeah, that's totally different.
Some others of us might have gone in with 80s rose-colored nostalgia glasses. And I think that will become apparent as we talk about the movie, because I might have some very unpopular opinions. And I'm going to tell you now, putting my right hand up and on a Bible, I promise to not be aggressive, as I no doubt will be playing devil's advocate throughout most of this episode, primarily as I point out that maybe, just maybe, Blane was much more of a jerk than Steph ever was.
And she's going to be the mom. She's going to be the mom.
That just got me.
Guys, I brought
receipts. Carolyn, I'm with you.
Well, okay, so a quick fact check. Pretty in Pink was released on February 1st, 1986. Like I said, I was a junior in high school. Kristen was a senior, and Carolyn apparently was like married. Just kidding. She was in college. It was written, of course, by John Hughes and directed by Howard Deutsch. Now, John Hughes, by Pretty in Pink time, he's done Vacation, Mr. Mom, 16 Candles, Weird Science, Breakfast Club, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, either written or directed, produced those movies. After Pretty in Pink, of course, as we know, he'll go on to do Some Kind of Wonderful, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, She's Having a Baby, The Great Outdoors, Uncle Buck, Home Alone. The list goes on. Mm-hmm. Howard Deutsch directed Pretty in Pink, and it was his directorial debut. Previously, he had directed like music videos for Billy Idol and Billy Joel. He would go on to direct the next John Hughes movie, Some Kind of Wonderful, and then The Great Outdoors. But on Some Kind of Wonderful, he would meet his wife, who he's still married to this day, Leah Thompson. And their daughters are both actresses. You might know Zoe Deutsch. She was in the Netflix series The Politician, and she was in the cute Netflix rom-com Set It Up. She is a really cute, great young actress. But it's a little fun fact that Howard Deutsch married Leah Thompson. Okay. As far as box office, you guys know how movies that become phenomenons and typically have small box office earnings, but then they get really popular after they've ended their theatrical run. Not the case for Pretty in Pink. It made $40 million on a $9 million budget, which is considered small, a small budget. And it was really well received from the start. It hit number one at the box office. And even today, all these years later, it holds a 79% fresh on Rotten Tomatoes, which, you know, means it's a quality
that's
movie,
decent.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Pretty. We all look to Rotten Tomatoes, right? It's our barometer.
I do.
How many of those little splats do we see? Brian and I do it all the time. Like, if we're like, I don't know about this movie, check Rotten Tomatoes. So the movie, it's an age-old plot, right? The rich boy and the poor girl love each other, but the rich kid's friends are snobs, and the poor girl is embarrassed about her home and her life, and how dating someone in a different class, like a totally different sphere, is not easy. Yet, they do. They find their happily ever after, because of course they do. But, fun fact, I'm going to tell you all about later, this movie almost did not end this way. This movie was not intended to end this way. Howard Deutsch says he set the whole movie up to not end this way. But it did, and we'll tell you
and
why.
And I just have to tell you that, and like, we won't say what it is now, but I did not know that, Michelle, until you told me that
a couple of
days ago. I did not know that. And I have to tell you, I feel so much better.
Obviously, I didn't know it until, you know, probably 20 years after, you know, I saw it. We'll get into why it didn't bother me in a little bit. But listeners, today, we're not going to just retell the story to you. If you're listening to this, we're fairly sure you're a fan of Pretty in Pink and know how the story plays out. So what we're going to do instead is just have an organic reaction chat about the movie we all just rewatched together, as Carolyn said, a few days ago. And you guys, we have no idea where this is going, which, to be honest, listeners, that's a little uncomfortable for us. And we might jump all over the place, but we know you'll hang in there and keep up with us, because we know that all of you, other than Carolyn, have this movie tattooed on your brain, right? So let's get into it. We pan into the Walsh house, and Andie is just waking up for the day, and she's having to wake up her dad. She says, "Daddy, it's 7:30. Daddy, wake up." And right away, their relationship is defined. So let's talk about that relationship.
That whole first scene and the relationship in general, but the way she's so maternal with him, and she's really like, "You've got to get up. You have an appointment at this. I'll get you your coffee. Here's your juice." And I was so uncomfortable with that. And I wondered, what's wrong with her dad? Like, is he sick? I even in my mind, I sort of made up the fact like, oh, he must be an alcoholic.
That's what I told
myself. But they don't really tell you. They give you sort of a reason for why dad is having a difficult time getting out of bed. But they weren't explicit enough for me as a teenager. And I was always wondering, why is she put into that role? And I need more information.
Well, you don't get it right away. You certainly get it through a conversation they'll have towards the end of the movie. But you, at the beginning, I agree with you, Kristen. I can't know back in 1986 what I thought, but I'm sure that I went to alcoholic.
Yeah.
That's what I'm sure. And not a nice person. So I really appreciate that right away it's established that he's a nice guy.
He's a loving person.
He's a loving father.
And he's appreciative of her. Yeah.
And Harry.
Which is still kind of weird.
Yes. Well, Harry
Carolyn,
Stanton.
Yeah. What did you think? Because,
I loved him. I loved him in this movie. I thought he was probably the best actor, to be honest with you, in the whole movie.
He's great. Yeah.
I loved their relationship. I loved that, to overuse a word that's used a lot, but he was kind of vulnerable. I mean, he really was kind of real, and he loved her so much. I mean, you could just tell how much he loves her.
One thing that I have always appreciated in this movie is, yes, Andie has the line between daughter, wife, and mother is blurred for poor Andie. She carries a lot on her shoulders, a lot. And I'll talk about later, maybe when we get into why the whole premise and the ending of this movie didn't bother me, is because in my mind, Andie is such a strong character. She's someone that I admired for so many different reasons. One, just that she's so comfortable in her own skin, right? To put that ensemble together and go to school. But man, you guys, she has got it under control. She has that whole morning under control, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Well, she's had to do it for a long time, I'm sure, because you figure he's been that way ever since her mom left.
Yeah.
And I think we learn later, it's been a chunk of time. It's not like it was yesterday or last week, or it's been several years. So.
And we can assume that maybe he has been not working or in bed since that event happened. Right. And so one of her primary goals is to try to get him to get to a job interview. Right. And that's the part that's really hard, because that's where I'm wondering about the mental illness. Was there depression or something like that?
Oh, yes.
Because that's the only time their relationship gets contentious is when he doesn't show up for a job interview.
Mm-hmm. I just respected her so much. And I don't know if it's because as a child, I had a lot on my shoulders as well.
Yeah,
and I saw a lot in Andie. I recognized a lot in Andie of myself.
You know, I hope I'm not the only in the world that knows what an incredible person you are.
Well, at this point in time, I'm afraid you are, honey.
Carolyn, what did you think? What are your first impressions of Duckie Dale?
My first impressions of Duckie are just, you know, he's kind of eccentric and eclectic, and he's just kind of out there and then annoying. I mean, I'll just go right to it. Did I like him? I thought he was entertaining, I guess.
Yeah.
I'm not sure about the character itself. I think I had to wait till I got into the movie a little bit more. If you're just talking about first impressions, when I first saw him, I was just like, oh, there's the, you know, what I said, like maybe little brother, the good friend, whatever. And they look exactly alike.
Yeah. The writing for him is so good. Duckie is so clever, and he's got this constant patter of funny little things that, you know, funny little observations that he has, which really separates him, again, from the Richie Rich people.
Yeah.
He's clever in a way that those people can't be clever.
Mm-hmm.
And so, to me, Duckie is the sexy one.
Oh, for sure. Duckie's also a huge contradiction, because if you think about it, he's got that same self-assuredness to be able to wear what he wears and the shoes he wears and do his hair like he's straight from the, you know, the 1950s. He's secure enough to be his own person, but he's also, his character is written way more insecure than I think than Andie's is, even though they both obviously.
Yeah. And his vulnerability is for a very specific purpose, and that's because he's in love with her.
Yeah. No, that's why we're just skipping all over. Because
well,
that brings up
insecurity.
And that brings up a good point. You said, and because that bedroom scene, it's the classic big sister helping the little brother study for a test. Duckie, pay attention. Duckie, why did you write this down? He's like, I did. Uh-huh. Okay. And that means, you know, and she's like, Duckie, be serious. It's so that that dynamic. And then she leaves to go get the juice boxes. And this is when we see Duckie be vulnerable for the very first time.
Oh, God. I love this woman. I love this woman, and I have to tell her. And if she laughs, she laughs. And if she doesn't love me, she doesn't love me. But if I don't find out... love her too much.
And all of a sudden he's very vulnerable, because when she comes back in, he has to leave. You know, drinking and driving don't mix. That's why I ride a bike. He has to leave. All of a sudden, it's the first time we see like he has a heart. He's more than just this funny kind of quirky character who has these funny one-liners.
Yeah, then that's when we realize that his funny one-liners might be nerves.
Well, right. But I got to go back to Kristen, your comment a second ago about that's why you think Duckie is the sexy one. And I guess if I can bring this stuff up now, if we're going to go forward in the movie,
yeah.
I mean, he was the most annoying, stalkish-like little brother that wouldn't just get out of the way no matter how many times she told him. I mean, okay, so we have the scene with the answering machine, and he left all of those messages on the answering machine.
He's a little obsessed.
Do you remember back in the day, like, you only had a certain amount of space on your little tape on the answering machine? So if somebody keeps calling, then that means other people might not be able to call. Super annoying. I mean, then he admits to riding by her house like 100 times on his bike. I'm finding that hard to believe for my little Kristen, for Kristen to think that behavior can
maybe
lead
sexy,
to some,
maybe appealing.
It could be I compartmentalize that a little bit, because it could be that I'm really drawn to his repartee, right? And I'm putting the obsessive things over in the closet.
Okay.
I'm pretending that part doesn't exist, because the way that he speaks and his cleverness is just so, he's so thoughtful, and he's able to be so funny in sort of a deep way. And that to me is sexy.
I think for me, between Blane and Duckie, let's leave how I felt about Andrew McCarthy's looks out of it. Duckie is the character to me that I am more attracted to because it's his sense of humor.
Both Andrew McCarthy and James Spader. Is that his name? James Spader?
Yes.
Okay, did I get it right? They're wearing these like suits with the t-shirts underneath. They're wearing suits to school. And I was like, is this what they wear in Chicago? Right?
No,
and so nobody in my school was dressed like that. And it really reeked so much of privilege in it. So in that way, it did its job, but it was really off-putting. And maybe that could be because of where I come from. So that's what I'm bringing with me, because I went to a giant school. At the time, it was the biggest school in the state, but we didn't really have haves and have-nots the way they do in this movie. So my feelings about seeing them in their Miami Vice style would have immediately brought up for me the rivalry between the richy rich suburbs that we had.
Well, and that was done so purposefully, I think. Yeah. So, I mean, there's articles everywhere online about how there is no way Steff, James Spader, was a high schooler. It said Spader is so unbelievable as a high school senior that his performance nearly crosses over into farce. And it says, maybe it does. The writers left him no choice. And I think what you said, yeah, we didn't have anybody that wore seersucker suits and looked like, you know, many hedge fund guys walking around our campus. But I feel like that was done very purposefully by the writer, by the costume people, to make this. The whole movie is based on the class difference. So they almost want to shove it in our faces more by making Andie and Duckie dress the way they do and making Steff and Blane dress the way they do. It's exaggerated. And I think it's exaggerated on purpose. I don't think they ever said, we're trying to reflect how real high school kids dress.
You
and
have
act.
To pick a team.
I would say there's zero chance they were doing that. I think they were doing it to just overemphasize the class difference. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, we brought him up now, so I'd like to see if this is when we could chat a little bit about Steff.
Let's do it.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
You know, I've liked you for 4 years and you treat me like shit. You know, I don't understand that.
Okay. Because I want to go back to the scene where we very first meet him. So that's kind of at the end of the school day of that very kind of first scene where we're getting introduced to everybody. And I have gone back and watched this scene several times for a variety of reasons, and not the least of which is James Spader's gorgeous face, but also to really dissect the scene, okay? Mm-hmm. Because I don't think that he is the complete jerk that everyone wants to say he is in that scene, okay? So we're going to just dissect it a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'm going to say right now, it is not nice when he calls her a bitch, but I got to say, she's acting kind of bitchy. So this is the first time we see him. He's in his car talking to his friends, maybe strategically parked right in front of her purple Karmann Ghia. He sees her come out of the out of the school to her car through his rearview mirror. Very obviously to his friends that are there, like, I gotta go. I need to, you know, he's not ashamed that he's going back to talk to her. And so at one point, I think we all think watching it, and particularly as a high schooler, that yes, maybe he is propositioning her. But he says to her, I'd like to basically get together, and I'm talking about more than sex here. And she doesn't believe him. She's like, no, you're not. Like, right off the bat, he didn't say anything at all sexual. Then he says, I've liked you for 4 years and you treat me like shit. And let's believe him. Let's not assume anything. Let's believe what the character is telling us. I think a lot of people maybe make some assumptions that he's teased her, he's pinched her butt for 4 years, whatever. We don't know any of that. He said he's liked her for 4 years. And he makes it sound like she's been this kind of standoffish, assumed the worst about him just because he was rich. And he says to her, I've been with a lot of girls in the school and I don't see what makes you so different. That is his line. Mm-hmm. I don't see what makes you so different. You act like you're all different because maybe this class thing, whatever. But I don't, basically, if we're taking him at his word, I don't see what makes you so different. And then she comes back with, because I have taste. And it's in this moment that you can see Steff is kind of hurt. Okay, if you're staring at James Spader like I was staring at James Spader, he's kind of hurt. What do we do as humans oftentimes when we get hurt? We want to hurt someone right back. We want to give them some pain. And that's when he calls her a bitch. And that's when he, in my opinion, was hurt and kind of a little sad.
Okay, this is so interesting, Carolyn, because I'm now seeing that there's a big difference between, we all take in different messages, right? It's like, what things are we paying attention to? You reading those words, it's like, I was not paying attention to his words. I was only paying attention to his aura or his being and mm-hmm. the way and his stance. And so like the way that he approaches her and he gets in her face and he sort of overpowers her by leaning on his car. And you know, in that way, when people are trying to they're trying to be a big man. And when that happens to me, I immediately, my defenses go up and I would act like Andie. I'm not listening to those words at all. And you're right. Those words are a person who is, I mean, we could have a whole different version of this movie if it comes from the fact that he's liked her for 4 years. And right. then why does he, at the end of the movie, why is she the enemy and why does he say that she's trash? Is it all? Is it because he's a dick or is it because he's rejected?
His ego couldn't take it. You mm-hmm. know from the beginning that. But at the very end, Blane says, you couldn't buy her, though. That's what's killing you, isn't it, Steph? That's it, Steph.
Yeah, yeah.
She thinks you're shit. And deep down, you know she's right. I just feel like if you watch that first scene, you absolutely mm-hmm. would feel that. Oh, we liked her for 4 years. That's kind of sad. They make him, the way he's dressed, the way they want you to know right away who he is. But by the time you get to the end, you see that you have a ton of evidence that that's how he treats everybody and everything. He treats Blane like shit, lots of quotes to support that. He treats Benny like shit when he just had sex with her. He tells her she's worthless. He treats school like shit. He's not in class when he's supposed to be. He treats his parents' house like shit because he's like, why would I treat my parents' house like this if money meant anything to me? At the end, he gives his best friend an ultimatum and says, if you're going to date her, you're losing me as a friend, basically. So that's why I have zero empathy for Steph. And I feel like he's a big dick. Certainly, though, if you go back and say, wow, he liked this girl for 4 years and she didn't like him, that's sad, but it doesn't make me have any sympathy right. for him.
Okay, I'm going to say I don't think he is a jerk. He does tons of jerky things in the movie, so I'm not trying to excuse any of that. But I also think some of those scenes that you brought up, I don't think he's necessarily being as jerky as we think he is. And I'd like to propose a theory here. If he's liked her for 4 years and he is really good friends with Blane, do we not maybe think that Blane knows that Steph
has, he does know.
But could Blane perhaps have known from the beginning that Steph had feelings for
I don't think so, because he asks what her name, he says, who were you talking to out there, when he's out on the smoking patio? And Blane looks at him and he's like, why do you want to know? So like Steph has acted to Blane this whole time like he doesn't know who Andie is.
I think what we know, I think what this is really, this is giving a lot more stock to the movie, because I yeah. think what we're dealing with here is that we have a much more nuanced character than we think, because we have a person who is rejected, who cannot divorce himself from his privilege. The privilege exactly. has turned him into a monster.
Well,
but that doesn't mean
exactly.
that he's not a human being. And to your point, Michelle, that doesn't mean that you forgive him, but it means you look at him with a much bigger brush, right?
It's
a,
maybe.
There's far more nuance here than we thought. It doesn't right. give him any license to be the asshole
totally.
That he right. is.
But I think, like you just explained, you just said it, Kristen, it's this privilege. Like, he doesn't know how to deal with some of this pain. I mean, you said it in the very beginning.
He has
you said
no
this
idea.
Movie is about privilege and pain. And
yeah.
I could mm-hmm. not agree more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, from the fact that he has all these parties at his parents. His parents are never home, okay?
Right.
And he's gotten kind of everything he's wanted. I'm sure they've just thrown money at him and whatever, you know, to make him feel better. And so he's used to getting what he wants, doesn't know maybe how to deal with not getting what he wants. And again, when he, I think, is feeling pain, his immediate reaction is to make others feel pain. That's kind
well,
of
absolutely.
What his...
Absolutely. You
and
seize
he
your
does
power.
That very yeah. well, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And that's where the jerk part is apparent 100%.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, any of us, if you think, well, I'll speak for myself, sometimes when someone hurts me, I immediately want to respond with a way to hurt them. So
You fling. I can't, never mind, because I can't think of what that yeah. word is.
Well, I think it's indisputable
that anytime in any movie you see someone who's a bully, it's coming from a place of pain, for sure. There's a reason behind it. Anytime that's in a movie or in real life, anybody that's bullying someone or saying mean things to someone, that's coming from a place of pain. They have some shit to work out.
What that means is that we think of this as a love story. This movie is being a love story between Blane and Andie. And really what this is a movie about Andie and Steph and really Duckie, right? Mm. And Blane is almost... Blane is a reduced character.
Honestly, I think we know more about Steph's character and Andie's character are the two we know the most about in this entire movie.
Oh, yeah, you know nothing about Blane. We know nothing about Blane.
Anything about Blane, but we know...
Oh, that's so interesting.
The biggest insight we get on Blane is when Steph is giving... They're in Steph's office, and he's giving him that ultimatum, and
Steph's
he says,
office.
Your parents...
He has an
it
office.
Was his office, or it was his dad's
study.
Office.
It's his
dad's it looks like it's... It looks like
and
his...
He's, yeah, he's sitting at a big desk.
His parents are never there.
In his robe.
Right. So he's basically saying, he says, when Bill and Joyce get through with you, you won't know whether to shit or go sailing. It's the only time we get any insight into Blane's life at all.
I'm really sorry for bumming out the night for you.
Didn't bum out anything. Had a great time.
Liar.
I was with you. I had a great time. I was in a Turkish prison. I'd have a great time with you.
I don't know. It's just... It's too weird for me, you know? Maybe this shouldn't happen.
What, you and me? Well, you know, maybe it doesn't happen all the time. It doesn't mean it isn't right, right?
It's a terrible date all the way around. He starts out the date by insulting her, by saying, do you want to go home and change? And she says, I already did. And he doesn't then say, oh, my God, I was joking. You look great. He just chuckles. When she says, I already did, he doesn't at all come back with a compliment about her blue dress and her little cute sweater. He just keeps walking. He's tossing his keys in the air. Wants her to go to a party that she does not want to go to. He makes her go to the party. They go to the party. They get stuck in the room. He doesn't immediately leave when she's being bullied so viciously by Benny. Benny's calling him terrible words, terrible slurs. Mm-hmm. He sits there and takes it. So we know a lot about his character from that scene. Mm-hmm. It's a terrible date. They go to the club. Duckie almost punches Blane. It's a terrible, terrible date. And then he says, would it make you feel better if I ask you to prom? And she goes nuts. That's when I lose respect for Andie.
Yeah, okay, that's a good point.
That she doesn't say no.
I want to go back to the date. I want to just make a couple points with you guys. One is, when he gets there, if you remember, he walks her through like the entire first floor of that house. And, you know, everyone's looking up and down and kind of like, why is he here with her? Whether he's showing her off or whether he's looking for Steph to say, oh, look who I have brought with me. Then all of a sudden he wants to go upstairs. That's when I was like, you don't ask something. You maybe say, let's go outside and talk. Or do you want to ditch this place?
We know the what upstairs means.
We know that. Or in my thought of him wanting to make Steph mad, they go upstairs. Of all the rooms they go to the room that Steph is in. Like, that's bizarre. They don't leave when they open the door and see he's half dressed.
That's weird. Yes.
I feel like there's something there.
That's weird.
When it's almost like I got her, you didn't, and I want to make sure you saw it. Because if they had left, Steph would have never seen her. And yes, and Michelle, you did let me interrupt you before and just say that James Spader was kind of the nice guy in that situation in terms of telling Benny to be quiet and then finally dragging her out. Like, you need to whatever. I forget he said. I mean, he's definitely.
I guess if you think being nice is saying, oh, let's go get you some ribs. I'm going to take you to throw up. That's how he tells her to stop talking.
Again,
he tells her
that
we need to get you something to eat. We need to get you some ribs.
But at the same time, the reason I guess he was being a jerk towards her was because she was being a jerk towards Andie and wanted to escort her out. He didn't glom on when she was being bitchy to either of them. I mean, he didn't say, whatever. I just
But when she calls his best friend a faggot, he doesn't say, he just says, let's go. He doesn't turn to her and defend that.
No, he doesn't at all.
You know, so.
But really, Blane, I mean, these two guys are in good company, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's hard to say who's the worst of the two, because Blane takes Andie to this party, despite the fact that she has overtly said no so many times.
So many
times. No, no, no. And he just pushes, come on, come on. I mean, you can see the metaphor very clearly. Like, just take off your underwear. I actually don't think he was trying to take her upstairs to have sex with her. I don't think that. I think he was being stupid And I think he was being entitled, and he wanted to, he was going to the place where he was comfortable.
This is for sure.
His turf, right? And she is saying, please don't do this. Please don't make me do this. And he's almost coercing her into going to this party where the minute they walk in, the eyes upon her, she, it's overt how people feel about her. It's not fun, to your point, Michelle. It's not fun at all. And then he's like, come on, let's go upstairs. Again, how many times does she say no?
Yeah.
And he just keeps pushing. It's classic 1980s rapey boy behavior.
Oh, it's classic John Hughes.
His intention is not to rape her.
It's classic
John
Hughes,
that's not his intention. But I'm like, dude, listen to the words coming out of her mouth. And so then the fact that at the end of the night she wants to go to prom with him, I'm with you, Michelle. I'm like, what are you doing? This guy's a dick.
Well, I think it's to, I think it's also to illustrate the whole, don't forget, the movie Pretty in Pink was written because Molly Ringwald liked this song. When they were filming Breakfast Club, she was playing it. John Hughes heard it, wanted to write a movie, Pretty in Pink, and he wrote the character of Andie for Molly Ringwald. It's going to culminate at prom. So we need a way. We need a way to make prom a really big deal, right? We're making this movie about prom that's going to be a really big deal. So I think this is just illustrating, too, how big of a deal this prom is to Andie. It's a really big deal to her. And it's also a little out of character that prom would be that big of a deal to her.
Yeah,
I think. You don't, you from the beginning, you don't necessarily think that she's the type of girly girl who's really going to get all jazzed about going to prom. But then you also kind of think, well, maybe she doesn't like, maybe there's something she does like in him. I mean, that we're not seeing.
Because my only future plans are to make sure that she's taken care of.
That's nice of you, Phil.
And I'd like to marry her.
I really don't want to lose time to talk about the pain of Duckie because we're going to switch gears a little bit because Duckie Dale to me is the movie Pretty in Pink. It is him that makes this movie for me. It is him from the very first time I saw it. This movie was a movie pretty much with John Cryer and Molly Ringwald and Andrew McCarthy, who I thought was cute and was on my wall. It was always about the relationship between Andie and Duckie and just the character of Andie. And we've talked a little bit about the brother-sister dynamic, but I want to talk about the scene in Tracks, the Try a Little Tenderness scene.
Yeah.
Because to me, this is my favorite scene in the movie. It's the most important scene in the movie between Andie and Duckie's relationship. And I would argue that it's probably one of the, I would say it's the best scene in the movie.
Yeah.
So just to set it up, Andie's waiting for Blane to pick her up at 7 earlier in the day. She's gotten sent to the principal's office at gym. Duckie comes flying out of home ec, you know, Andie, are you okay? Are you okay? Okay. I left home ec for you. And he's like, okay. He's like, I'm going to take you away this weekend. Do you fish? You know, and he's, he wants to take her away. And he's like, I'll pick you up at 7. And she's just sort of that annoying little brother. She does not say, no, Duckie, I have a date with Blane for probably obvious reasons, right? He doesn't hear that because he's, you know, persistent. So she's sitting waiting and she's at Tracks. And this is when Duckie comes sliding in. And this is the Try a Little Tenderness serenade is what I like to think of it as. But it's basically him lip syncing it. Fun facts, you guys, John Cryer worked with Kenny Ortega on the choreography of this scene.
Oh my God, you're kidding.
And this would have been right before Dirty Dancing. And then, of course, he went on to do High School Musical and other things. But I want to read you this from an article I found. I love this. John Cryer said, this is just, you know, a few years ago when it was the 30th anniversary, it was everywhere. So there's tons of articles you can find. And I'm going to post some of these in the Weekly Reader this week. But John Cryer says, I'm not a dancer, obviously, Cryer jokes while watching Duckie dance and lip sync to Try a Little Tenderness by Otis Redding. But it was funny because when I showed the director what I wanted to do in the scene, they cleared the shop and I had performed it full out and he didn't say anything afterwards. Turns out, Howard Deutsch's blank expression was hiding his irritation. Cryer's dance was so good that Deutsch realized they'd have to extend production to capture it in all its glory.
Oh, no.
We lost a whole day in the schedule in the very first week, Cryer says, because when he saw it, he's like, oh, this is great. We're using this, right?
Yeah.
So anyway, obviously, he comes in, he serenades her.
I just have to say, that scene in the movie is Pretty in Pink for me.
Yeah.
Duckie serenading Andie with Otis Redding is Pretty in Pink.
It's so good, you guys. I'm going to put that whole scene in the Weekly Reader, and then we're going to go all the way into the fight, because the fight for me is what we're about to talk about. So we're going to fast forward a little bit through that great scene to the point when Andy's in the bathroom. Duckie doesn't know why she's so upset. Iona's saying, don't waste good lip gloss, sweetie. So she says...
Because Blane has not shown up. Yeah.
Right, right.
She's being stood up.
And then he says, that's what I'm about to say. Yep. She says, she got stood up, twerp, to Duckie. And Duckie's like looking around like, wait. What are you, I'm here, you know, like I'm here. And then Blane shows up. And you guys, Duckie's face falls. John Cryer, this is a brilliant piece of acting by John Cryer. He's been goofy. He's done the Try a Little Tenderness. He's so excited. He's like, let's blow this popsicle stand. Let's go. And then he just goes, Andie? And his face goes through so many degrees of pain. It's not even funny. He realizes she's going out with Blane. And you guys, it's so much more about her going out with a Richie than it is about her going out with somebody who's not Duckie. Because he says, you know, they shit on everybody, including you. And she says, I'm not going to let them shit on me. And he says, he's going to use your ass and throw you away. I would have died for you. I would have died for you, he says. When he first says, wait, what? You're going to go out with this guy? Is this a date or something? And then he walks away. And then after he says, I would have died for you. He says this.
I'm not particularly concerned with whether or not you like me. Because I live to like you and I can't like you anymore.
Kills me. Mm-hmm. And so this is a huge division right now between Andie and Duckie's relationship. Because after this is when we're going to sort of fast forward. We're going to see all of the Andie going through all the stuff with Blane now. But yet, throughout the rest of the movie, we're going to see little glimpses of Duckie's pain, whether that's him still riding his bike by her house a whole bunch of times. I love that part. God, that makes me laugh. And when he's just sitting on his bed, and oh my God, that scene, you really get his life. You know, you see his home life, you see where he lives.
I think that sometimes people try to make this movie into that there is equal disdain on both sides, that, you know, you can't judge the poor people for being poor and you can't judge the rich people for being rich. But I'm not buying that, because this is not an equal playing field, right? The richies, they hold all of the power. Mm-hmm. They have a whole team of richie riches who will be mean to the people who they believe are lesser. Duckie is a team of one. He has no team.
Little duck.
And yet he still fights. He still fights with no backup whatsoever. And he knows he can't win, but he fights nonetheless. And their disapproval is not equal, because Steph disapproves. Well, we can add Carolyn's argument into this too, but on the surface anyway, Steph disapproves of Andie because she's trash. Benny disapproves of Andie because she's trash. We could also say Steph disapproves because he's feeling rejected. But the group as a whole disapproves of them because they're trash. Whereas Duckie disapproves of Blane because, number one, he's in love with her. But number two, because he's afraid of what Blane will do to her.
He is. He says he's
afraid that she'll be destroyed, that he'll be cruel to her, which he is, right? So Duckie is right. So it's not a both and good people on both sides situation, which I think was their intention a little bit. Like, we can't judge each other this way.
They try to prove that point by having Andie say, I'm probably going to get it a little bit wrong. I'm going to go off my memory. But when in that argument, she's yelling at Duckie and she says, if we don't like them because they have money, it's the same thing as them not liking us because we don't. She's trying to say that. And he's, yes, exactly, Kristen. Mm-hmm. She says that right after he says, you know, they shit on everybody, including you. And that's when she says, I'm not going to let them. He's trying to, though, say, but are you seeing what, like, basically what they've been doing? I mean, even look at the teachers. Mm-hmm. Look at how John Hughes wrote it. And again, I do think that so much of this, from the wardrobe to the situations they put them in to, Blane being a dick to her and the party and all this stuff, I think it was very exaggerated. And I think it was done on purpose. I think it was very intentional for us to see this whole trope storyline. And it's a movie, right? At the end of the day, it's a movie. It's just a movie. Even in all the classroom scenes, from the math class was it math or history, to the gym scene, the teachers are going to side with Benny and with her friends.
That's right. The teachers
are always. Andy's the one that's getting in trouble. So we're seeing that it's not just the kids that are against these people or thinking they're trash. Even the principal, because he says, you're lucky to get an education like this. And she's like, I know I'm lucky. He's like, that's not what I mean, basically, you know?
But one thing, so I do just want to point out as we're discussing this movie, that these were teenagers. I mean, they're supposed to be. The characters are teenagers. I mean, honestly, some of the things that you guys had said before, well, I don't know why she does that. I don't know why she went upstairs. I'm over here raising my hand going, I would have gone upstairs.
You're right. You're right. And I probably would too. I probably would too.
I think,
and she didn't want to, though.
I know. I wouldn't have wanted to either. But I would have done it. And I guess maybe I'm talking about the prom part where you were like in disbelief that she would have said yes to go to the prom with him, where I'm thinking I might have said yes. Mm-hmm. And and these supposedly these characters, I know we think James Spader is 35 when he's doing it, but they're supposed to be, you know, teenagers 18. Whose frontal lobe, you know, all that good stuff is not developed. They're doing teenager kind of jerky things. And I don't want to speak for you guys, but we had, you know, those jerks in my high. I mean, I think it was a common, this behavior was not that out of character for what a teenager would do.
Well, he's portraying it for a reason, right? He's portraying it to show. And I think the enduring legacy of John Hughes's work is that he got high school right. Right. He portrayed, whether it was exaggerated or not, he got the dynamic right, that basically we're tribal beings and we're going to find our people. We're going to find our teams. And in order to for your team has to win. And in order for your team to win, you have to shit on the other team.
And in a movie situation like this, you have to exaggerate it. If he actually portrayed high school as your high school, my high school, it'd be boring to watch. You have to exaggerate it. You have to make it amplified, right? You have to make all the groups, the Richies, the jocks, the nerds, the goths, the theater kids. Mm-hmm. In every movie, they're exaggerated. They just are. I don't know that you could go to any high school and it's exactly like you see in the movies, but you have to exaggerate it so that we all get it. We all understand it. Yeah. And I was not at all in disbelief that she agreed to go to prom with him. I said I lost respect for her that she did. Yeah. I absolutely got her attraction. She thought he was so cute. He did that library, you know, the scene in the, I mean, he did really cute things for her. I just lost respect that after he treated her, after he didn't defend her at that party and he made her go to the party, first of all, he insulted her clothes, made her go to the party, didn't get her out of the party, that she would still say yes.
Kudos to Andie when it comes time. I think they're trying to show that, okay, first we're going to be on Blaine's turf at this party. That now we're going to go to Andie's turf and they're going to get shit on Andie's turf. But again, the playing field is not level because they go to the club where there's a band playing and that's neutral territory. That's not where all of her people are going to be. Remember, Duckie can't get into the club usually. So they don't know Ducky's going to be there. When they arrive and Duckie is there and Duckie starts being a dick because he's there with Andie, so he's feeling hurt.
Yeah.
Instead of like Blaine's kind of like mumble, stop saying mean things stuff, Andie is full-throated in her defense of Blaine. And they leave immediately, instead of sitting there on the couch in the bedroom.
Great point. All right, everybody, we're getting to prom because
okay,
in the interest of time. So, one thing I always wonder, even in 1986. Well, first of all, because we can't not mention it, we're going to mention this super quick and then move on. The dress is hideous. The dress is hideous. Molly Ringwald cried when the costumer showed her the dress in real life. She said the sketch they had shown her, what the dress was going to look like, she loved it. If you look at the dresses that she was given to make that dress out of, and that's what she came up with.
Okay, I will say, it's not that I liked the dress. I thought the dress was cool. I didn't like it because it was pink, but I thought the dress was cool.
It was a, she called it, God, I wish I could remember what she called it, an upside down triangle. That's what she called it. Mm-hmm. What I was going to say is the fact that she's going to go by herself, this is the rallying cry of this movie. This is the most famous line
Blane
in this movie
that almost,
she says, dad finds out she's going. He's like, what time is he going to be here to pick you up? Kind of odd that she hasn't told dad that, that she's not going, she's like, he's not. And he's like, but you're still going. And she says, I just want to let them know that they didn't break me. Yeah. And that's the Andie that we see from the very beginning. That's the Andie that's carrying the weight of the world on her shoulders, but she's so self-confident and so self-assured. So she's back. So we're like, hooray, yay, team Andie, right?
Yeah. I'm not sad about it. I'm not hurt. I mean, you know, I am hurt a little bit, but I know if I don't do it, I'll just feel a lot worse. I'm just going to go in, walk out, and come home.
You sure?
I'm Just want to let them know that they didn't break me.
Okay, so you guys, original ending was that Blane is not at prom and Duckie shows up. She sees him. They come toward each other. He lifts her up. The movie ends with him lifting her off her feet and spinning her around. That's the original ending of the movie. That's how the movie was written. That's how it was shot. That's how it went to screenings. During one of the first screenings, when the ending came and Duckie and Andie ended up together, the entire crowd booed. Some of them even got up to leave. And Howard Deutsch, the director who's sitting in the theater, says he couldn't believe it. He said the whole movie was built to have John end up with Molly. The whole movie was built to show that true love triumphs. Now, I have a problem with that because, yes, Duckie truly loved Andie, but I never for once got that Andie would reciprocate that love. For Duckie, I don't think it's impossible. I think it could have happened.
But we need a little more time.
But we needed to see that, right?
Yeah.
So they had to reshoot. So they bring Blane back in. Now, Andrew McCarthy, meanwhile, is already shooting another movie or something where his head is shaved. So they put this awful wig. All of them in the cast agree.
It's so bad.
It's a terrible wig. It's darker than his real hair.
When I first saw it, I was like, what happened to him? I knew something was wrong with
him. I just thought he had not slept for days and it was like all matted. I mean, totally fit the character for me.
It's like Kendall hair.
I had no qualms with it.
Mm-hmm. Well, and they have him say, so this obviously was written after the crowd boos and they have to rewrite. They have him walk up to her. They have him say, you said you couldn't be with someone who didn't believe in you. Well, I believed in you. I just didn't believe in me. Had they ended it right there, I would have bought it. But then they have him say, I guess to just make us really believe it. And this is exactly how he says it. Maybe I'll put this on YouTube. I wish I could do it how he does. He goes, he leans forward and he goes, well, you guys, I'm just such a lips not moving. Like, he's a ventriloquist.
Yeah.
He goes,
yeah.
I loved you. I love you. Always. I love you. Always. And he has zero expression on his face. Had he just ended it, you guys, with, I just didn't believe in me.
Yes.
You're like, okay, then. We forgive you because now it's prom.
Well, I'm going to backtrack a little. I think that the original way it was written, I would not have bought the romance of Duckie and Andie. I think it almost should have been just this, the friendship part, the part where he knows.
That is what endures.
Yes, yes. Why not
that's
that be
that's
it?
The winner.
Why not?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
When Duckie appears, so Andie is walking into the prom alone, and Duckie appears at the top of the stairs. And I'm crying.
I got goosebumps as you say that.
I'm crying.
Yes.
It's such a beautiful movie moment. It's a classic movie moment. That's movie history. And it gets stolen away when Blane comes over and does his weird mumbly shit with his full-on entitlement, right? He comes
and
over with his
terrible hair.
And his bad wig. And he just feels like he can take what he deserves. And Duckie is disenfranchised once again. They could have capitalized on that Duckie moment by just having him be there for her. See?
Yes.
I am here for you.
It could have been over then.
It could have been over.
Kristen, that illustrates that I just need to let them show they didn't break me. He's doing the same thing. He shows up at prom. So like almost like I want Andie to see she didn't break me.
Yeah.
Not in a mean, nasty way, but you know what? Friendship unite.
It breaks the whole rallying cry of I don't want them to see that they break me. It ruins that whole concept. And she turns around and goes to the guy who tried to break her.
Right. Because he says he loves her.
Yeah.
And then there's that look with the blonde on the dance floor.
I hate that.
I hate that part.
Yeah.
It was like,
I hate it. It's so dumb.
Also, you'll be pleased to know John Cryer hated the rewrite. One, because John Cryer was super happy with the original because he was like, I got the girl. I got the girl.
Yeah.
Right? And he hated the rewrite. Also, because they make him say, like I just said a minute ago, when they obviously they had a write in the script for Blane where he does the nice one, but then he has to end it with the I love you always. And then they make Duckie say, he came here alone, Andie. Like, defeated.
No.
Like, go for it. He says basically, he goes, go. Like, he tells her to go. He tells her to go follow him. He came here alone, Andie. Go follow him. So well, as me, much as I love a good romance.
He loved her so much that he was willing to let her go. Yes. Like that. That's the kind of vibe I got. I thought that was.
Well, I think that's what was the intention. Yeah, that was the intention. But they had so many mixed messages. And I think that's why I left that movie being kind of incredulous.
Yeah.
And feeling like that was the wrong ending. And having no idea that there was another ending that would have satisfied me more. Even though I wasn't falling for the romance piece.
Would it have satisfied you more?
Oh, yeah. Way
for
more.
For her to end up with Duckie.
I wouldn't be angry.
But would you have been like, no, she doesn't like Duckie like that?
I may have been like, huh. But I would have been, because of the movie moment when he comes out and she's like, he's there for me. And I maybe would have, here's what I would have done. I can tell you, I would have compartmentalized it. Mm-hmm. I would have said the lifting up in the air and the turning around in a circle would have been that they're there for each other. Right. And I would have pretended that it wasn't a romance. That's what I would have done.
You could have. I think they could have left that open to interpretation.
Let's do this. Yeah. Let's have a Pop Culture Preservation Society rewrite of the ending of Pretty in Pink. Because I think all three of us are in agreement that it should have ended with the strong, lifelong friendship without Blane even there. Blane needed
Blane there.
Oh, you do?
I want Blane there. I do. I want him to be there, and I want him to be alone, and I want him to be sad, and I want him even to come over, and you could still do the thing about, I think that line is important about, I always believe in you. Yeah. I just didn't believe in me. And then she could say, I'm happy for you, Blane. Now, why don't you take your newfound knowledge and go be a better person?
Yes.
I would have liked for them maybe to not even have walked into the prom. It's like seen each other in the hallway.
They go get burgers.
Oh, yeah. They see each other in the hallway. They go, and then they go running out to another, like,
that would be awesome.
Love it. Oh, you guys. All right. Well, that's it. That's a wrap.
We did it. We fixed it. Let's talk about the soundtrack for a little bit. Yeah. I bonded with the soundtrack, I think, more than I bonded with the movie. Huh. You know, per what you heard in the discussion, where I was just really angry at the end, and the movie hurt my feelings. So this added, I think the soundtrack really gave added context to the story. It was memorable music. It was modern music that cool kids would listen to. Mm-hmm. The Psychedelic Furs, OMD, Echo and the Bunnymen, The Smiths. This was music that I was kind of growing into at the time. It was aspirational music for me. And Rolling Stone included it in their list of the 25 greatest soundtracks of all time. It's at number, it sits at number 11.
Wow, that's great.
And people often wonder, like, what came first? Did the song come first or the movie? So when you have an eponymous song, Pretty in Pink, the movie is called Pretty in Pink, the song is called Pretty in Pink, you often assume that they created a theme song for the movie. But the opposite is actually true here. John Hughes was inspired by the song Pretty in Pink, which came out in 1981 by the Psychedelic Furs, and he wrote a movie to go along with it. They did re-record the song to give it more of a pop radio friendly vibe. But here's what I find interesting. It sounds like John Hughes wrote a movie based on a misinterpretation of the song. So what John Hughes heard was a song about a young girl who was dressed in pink, looking beautiful, possibly for the prom. But here's what the lead singer of Psychedelic Furs says about the song. The song is about a girl who sleeps around a lot and thinks that she's popular because of it. It makes her feel empowered somehow and popular. And in fact, the people she's sleeping with are laughing at her behind her back and talking about her.
Aww.
That's what the song Pretty in Pink is about.
Yeah.
And instead of the phrase Pretty in Pink referring to a lovely girl dressed for the prom, Pretty in Pink is actually a metaphor for being naked.
Oh, really?
Oh, my.
Yes. Yes, oopsie. And it sounds like the lead singer of the Psychedelic Furs are like, dude, it doesn't match. So, and after the movie came out, people started using the term Pretty in Pink. Like, this became part of the lexicon. You'd see it in the 17 prom issue. You would see it in fashion magazines. Yeah. And this freaked them out a little bit, because it felt so wrong, because what they intended the phrase to mean, and because they're like, oh my God, we coined a phrase that is now a part of our lexicon. Like, that's our legacy. So the soundtrack worked anyway, despite the fact that it was misinterpreted. And it's become a total classic of our generation. The film also has a couple of songs that aren't included on the soundtrack, which is kind of sad. But if you go look for a playlist on Spotify or Apple Music, it will include these songs. Most importantly, Otis Redding's Try a Little Tenderness. that scene with Duckie in the record store where he's serenading Andie and Iona. And it's not on the soundtrack. They didn't get licensed to use it on the soundtrack, which is really sad.
But it is sad.
Now we have Spotify.
Mm-hmm.
Also, Cherished by the Association. That was not on the soundtrack, but it's Copacabana. In the movie. Yeah, exactly.
What's your favorite song on the soundtrack, guys?
I'm embarrassed to say I don't know the soundtrack. I thought there was like one song, which was our very last song.
If you leave.
Well, and that's the song that's a bigger hit, actually. That's the song that more people associate with the movie, If You Leave by OMD. That's the song that people think of when they think of Pretty
right.
and Pink.
So that's really
not
all
the Psychedelic
I think
Furs.
Of.
Yeah.
It's such a great song, though. I mean, that's not a bad answer. My favorite is Wouldn't It Be Good? And they only play it when they only play the, and you hear it in the background, the first track scene. And you hear the na 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 as you're you know, you're kind of focusing in on tracks, and then it's in the background, and Iona's going around with a staple gun and stuff, and you can hear it in the back. But that's the song I wore out on my cassette.
I love that song.
Be on your side.
And it's not, and it's done by not the original artist. Who is the original artist?
Well, Nick Kershaw.
Nick
but
Kershaw.
Danny Hutton Hitters or something like that did it on the...
He's the lead singer of Three Dog Night.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. I know that's a weird pairing to me, but it works. It sounds like a... It doesn't sound like a late 60s rant. It sounds like a 1980s new wave hit.
Yeah. Yeah. Bring on the Dancing Horses. That's such a good one, too.
Bring on the dancing horses. That's Echo and the Bunnymen.
Jibber and the word
with every lie you've heard.
So this is what it looks like. This is great. Hey, wait a minute. Wait. You got doors on the stalls. They're not stuffed. Wait a minute. We don't have none of this stuff in the boys. Wait a minute. We don't got none of this. We don't got doors on the stalls in the boys' room. We don't have, what is this? What? We don't have a candy machine in the boys' room. We don't got none of that. None of that. I'm sorry. No, I want the principal here. I want him here this instant. I want now.
Well, let's get to a few of the quotes that have set up shop in our brains since 1986. Most of them, not surprisingly, came out of Duckie Dale's mouth, which is just further evidence that he may be one of the most iconic movie characters ever.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them that I love, may I admire you again today, he says. and then he says, hey, you want beauty? Look in the mirror.
God,
he says,
see?
And you can't say I'm off like a dirty shirt unless you go like this. I'm off like a dirty shirt. It's when he's talking to Jack outside and he's telling Jack that he's going to take care of Andie. He's going to
the physical humor. Is that what it's called?
Well,
so good. He's such a master.
You should say that because my next quote by Duckie is that's called a sense of humor. You should get one. They're nice. That's how he says it.
Yes.
I love
and he says
so
it just
many.
Like that. They're
yeah, there's
nice.
So many. And just some of his quips, like when, you know, she asks him if he wants anything to drink and he's like, oh, you know, beer, scotch, juice box. my favorite one that I will say a lot, even though my kids don't have still refused to watch the movie because how much I love it. And now my husband's like, you don't want them to watch the movie because they won't like it. As much as you do.
And it will
and
be
they
sad.
Won't get it.
Yeah.
And then I'll be like,
yeah.
Anyway, Iona at the beginning when she's like, applause, 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 when she's stapling the stuff. And then I love when she grabs Andy's face and she goes, and she says it in a baby voice and she goes, be kind to the duck man. And she grabs her cheek. So cute.
I felt that. I felt like Iona was being the grown up and she's trying to very gently mother Andie.
And she does her mouth like this and she goes, be kind to the duck man. Another thing I say all the time is, she's stapling and then the kid's gonna shoplift and she shoots the staple gum at him and he goes, hey, you missed my eye by an inch. And she goes, half an inch. Honestly, I love everything that comes out of Iona's mouth. It's pure gold. And listeners, know that we all think Iona is iconic. We just are running out of time. Maybe we'll have to devote an entire episode to her and the fabulous Annie Potts one day. Who knows? This is the quote that my friend Lisa and I said for the rest of our high school lives. And we probably went back and saw the movie a million times. But Blane comes in and he comes into tracks. Oh, you guys, the first time he comes into tracks and the door rings and he pushes his sunglasses up on his hair and his hair's long enough that it pulls it all back. Andrew McCarthy
looks
so cute. So he brings up the Steve Lawrence album and he goes, is this any good? And this is the line that this was mine and Lisa's response for everything. She goes, hot. white hot. And I have to say, last night I was reading these quotes to Brian, and he's like, test me on these and see if, like, you say a little bit of it, if I know it. And I just said, so Blaine's going to walk into the record shop and he's going to say, is this any good? And he's going to throw down the Steve Lawrence album. And without a beat, Brian goes, hot, white hot. I'm like, oh, I couldn't love you more right now. I couldn't love you more right now. Okay. Andie, I love this one. If somebody doesn't believe in me, I can't believe in them, which, as we've said, sets up Blaine's end line. She says that in the stable. She like makes him look at her and she says, hey, if someone doesn't believe in me, I can't believe in them. Steph, money means nothing to me. Do you think I treat my parents' house this way if it did? Andrew Dice Clay, I mean, he's got a great cameo in this. God, I love when he's telling. I love his scenes with Duckie, but then he goes, love's a bitch, Duck. Love's a bitch. And that's a big line. And then you guys, the most famous line of the movie, the rallying cry, is when Andie's going to prom anyway, even after she's been dumped. And her dad asks why she's still going. And she says, I just want to let them know that they didn't break me. Interesting fact is that this line has not only served as the defining message of the movie, but it was cut originally. They cut the line for time. And then one of the two, I'm going to forget which one, either Howard Deutsch or John Hughes, when they saw that it was cut, were like, nope, put that back in. And thank God they did, because think of it.
Right.
We had to have that line to really understand why she went to prom.
But and then it gets ruined by the end.
I know.
But like, we also put it back in if you're going to ruin it.
Yeah. Yeah. But we had to know it, because we had to know, like that just more solidified for me, at least, that her, the strength of character that Andie had.
So really, no matter how you feel about Pretty in Pink, whether it inspired you or angered you, this movie defined a generation. It defined high school. It gave voice to the universal high school rivalry between the haves and the have-nots. It's not a lighthearted throwaway movie. It's a movie worthy of discussion and worthy of sharing with your kids and asking how they feel about it. That's the conversation that I want to have. And if you successfully got your kids to watch it, please send us a message and tell us what they had to say.
I'm seriously, how?
First tell us how, and then tell us what they had to say. I'm just so fascinated with what our Gen Z kids have to say. In some ways, they are far wiser than we were when we were that age, and that makes me kind of proud. Thank you once again for sharing this time with us today, and we look forward to being with you again next week.
Yeah, you guys, this was a dream conversation for me. I still cannot believe this is how I get to spend my days. So thank you for coming and talking about Pretty in Pink with me finally. I've been wanting to do this movie for a long time, and this was so much fun. And thank all of you who are listening and for sharing our podcast with everyone you know and for leaving us ratings or reviews where you listen. That is such a great way to help us get heard by more people. And you guys, we have just the best group of supporters on Patreon who honestly keep this whole project we love and you love trucking along. They fill our tanks with gas. They help us keep the lights on. And we couldn't be more grateful. Today, we're giving a special thank you to patrons Jennifer, Heather, Julie, Melissa, Donna, Darby, and Colleen.
And as usual, we are going to have some fun extras that we include in our weekly reader this week. So if you are not already subscribed, please go to poppreservationist.com or to our link in bio on YouTube. We're going to include a link to a YouTube clip that's called 10 Things You Never Knew. And I probably need to watch that about Pretty in Pink.
I bet you know him now. I bet you know him now after this conversation.
Oh, yes.
In the meantime, let's raise our glasses for a toast courtesy of the cast of Three's Company. Two good times.
Two happy days.
To Little House on the Prairie. Cheers.
Cheers.
The information, opinions, and comments expressed on the Pop Culture Preservation Society podcast belong solely to Carolyn, the Crushologist, and Hello Newman, and are in no way representative of our employers or affiliates. And though we truly believe we are always right, there is always a first time. The PCPS is written, produced, and recorded in Minneapolis, Minnesota, home of the fictional WJM Studios and our beloved Mary Richards. Nanu Nanu, keep on trucking, and may the force be with you.
Something always happens whenever we're together. We get a happy feeling when we're singing.